stone set in your eyes. See the thorn twist in your side. I'll wait for you. Sleight of hand and twist of fate. On a bed of nails she makes me wait. And I wait without you. With or without you. With or without.
And the editor says that although we don't know who's behind it, he says, we say it is an expression of the depressed state that overwhelms the feeling of the victims, because the US is being silent and passive towards Israeli practices against Palestinians. Those are the words. And he said that we believe this could be the motive behind these attacks. So although no one has yet put the finger of blame on who it actually is, there is a big suspicion here in the Middle East, and perhaps, I think, amongst many, a hope that the motive behind it was to strike back at America for its support for Israel.
Frank Gardner in Cairo, thank you. Well, Dan Plesch is still with me here in the studio. I know it's very early days and one doesn't want to get too involved in speculation, but I'm sure everyone watching wants to try and make some sense of this. Mm. Who and what do you think could be behind it?
Well, one question is, could this level of organization have been carried out simply by a small terrorist group, or whether a country was behind it? That's one question.
State-sponsored terrorism.
State-sponsored, state-organized. That has to be one question.
But would any state likely get involved in an attack like this on the world's only superpower, bearing in mind the possible consequences?
I would simply respond by saying, were these attacks likely? Was Timothy McVeigh likely? If you're asking me to explore the options, that's one. The obvious candidate is Bin Laden, but then he was top of the list, or his people like him were top of the list at the time of the Oklahoma City bombing. So you have to be very careful not to jump to conclusions. And of course, in the White House, there will be enormous pressure to jump to conclusions and get anybody just to try to resolve the issue.
If it were Osama bin Laden, what would his motive be? I mean, he's declared a virtual state of war, hasn't he, with the United States, so any attack against your enemy, I suppose, in his books is a good thing. But what is the strategy? What is the motive?
Well, one motive is simply revenge, and a second motive has to be to try to get the United States to dramatically change its policy. But I think you have to remember that bin Laden was originally funded by the Central Intelligence Agency in Afghanistan to fight the Soviets. He was originally funded and organized by them, and consequently knows a good deal of the way in which the American psyche works.
And it works the other way too, presumably. American intelligence will know a good deal about him.
Well, yes, and obviously part of the examination will be who knew what when, and we will probably find that there were some messages somewhere in the system that weren't taken seriously enough, as tragically tends to happen in these sorts of occasions.
But if he was trying to engineer American foreign policy, for example, in the Middle East, I mean, the last thing America could be seen to be doing is giving in to him.
Well, you and I might think that, but some people don't look at the world in that way. If people say the only thing that works is force, that works in both directions.
We'll leave it there for the moment. We've got some news just coming in, actually, that the Salomon Brothers building in New York, right in the heart of Manhattan, has also collapsed. This does fit in with a warning from the British Foreign Office a couple of hours ago to British citizens that there is a real risk. Let me get the exact words. The British Foreign Office, the Foreign Department of the British government, said there was a strong risk of further atrocities in the United States. And it does seem as if there now is another one, with the Salomon Brothers building collapsing. We've got no word yet on casualties. One assumes that the building would have been virtually deserted. Whether this latest collapse is going to influence the president, who we heard about a few moments ago, was expected to be heading from Nebraska back to Washington, we don't know. Dan Plesch, what do you think this is going to do to that crucial equation between, on the one hand, freedom, and on the other hand, security? The balance is going to change, I would guess, radically in the United States after this.
Americans pride themselves on their freedom, but I think we will see a real crackdown on the security front, particularly for access and traveling around in America on domestic airlines, which notoriously have been very, very open.
What will this do to the American psyche? You know them well, you've lived there.
I think the idea that the Americans will just retreat into themselves is nonsense. That was the Japanese hope when they attacked Pearl Harbor. But of course, the Americans responded massively to that. America, I think, will engage the world. We have to see whether they do it strongly.
Dan Plesch for the moment, thank you.
There's another one. I'm taking a look.
The United States under attack. Three hijacked planes crash into the heart of American power. Two rip through the twin towers of the World Trade Center. The devastation after both towers collapse, the extent of casualties is still unclear. Then in Washington, another plane crashes into a defense building at the Pentagon. Welcome to BBC World News. I'm Philip Hayton. Heavy loss of life and catastrophic destruction. That's the scene on the streets of New York after the United States suffers what many are saying is the worst attack on the country since Pearl Harbor. A huge operation is underway to find survivors from the wreckage of both towers of the World Trade Center in New York. They collapsed after hijacked airliners with passengers on board were flown into them. The 47-story Salomon Brothers building, situated very close to the World Trade Center, has also just collapsed. And part of the Defense Department, the Pentagon near Washington, continues to burn after another hijacked airliner plunged into it. The mayor of New York has said the casualties will be more than any of us can bear. There are no indications so far of who's behind the attacks. President Bush said those responsible would be hunted down. Our correspondent Mike Wooldridge has been following the day's events.
America's vulnerability to terrorism has never been exposed like this. The second hijacked plane flies into one of the twin towers of the World Trade Center and a fireball erupts around the 110-story building. The other tower was already ablaze after being hit by another plane only minutes earlier. One plane and one tower might just have been a terrible accident. That possibility was blown apart with the second direct hit. New Yorkers assumed they were reliving the 1993 bombing of this, one of the most famous landmarks of the capitalist world, but this was to be infinitely more audacious. Some of those trapped inside went to desperate lengths in the hope of rescue. The same desperation led others to jump to an inevitable death. There was pandemonium and panic in the streets around the Trade Center as the authorities tried to marshal people away from the area.
There's people jumping out of windows. I've seen at least 14 people jumping out of windows. It's horrific. I can't believe this is happening.
We heard a big bang, and then we saw smoke coming out, and everybody started running out, and we saw the plane on the other side of the building, and there was smoke everywhere, and people are jumping out the windows over there. They're jumping out the windows, I guess, because they're trying to save themselves. I don't know.
Within the hour, one of the huge towers, constructed to withstand all but the most apocalyptic of events, collapsed.
Thanks very much.
The whole side has collapsed.
The whole building has collapsed.
The attack was too devastating for the second tower as well, and not long after it too collapsed, filling the streets with yet more debris and dust. Thousands worked in these towers. No one had any idea how many casualties there were, But that they were mounting horrifically was obvious. The mayor of New York predicted that the death toll would be tremendous and ordered the evacuation of South Manhattan. Its streets took on an eerie appearance now as stunned people tried to make their way to safety. But the terrorists, it seems, had other designs. The very heart of the U.S. defense establishment was another of their targets. A third hijacked plane came down in a steep descent over Washington and crashed into the side of the Pentagon, setting off another huge blaze. Apparently, the evacuation of the building had been ordered a few minutes before, but had barely started. A fourth airliner came down in Pennsylvania, some 80 miles from Pittsburgh. This was the scene at the aftermath of that crash. By now, Americans were starting to portray it as the worst attack on their country since Pearl Harbor.
Once again, we see terrorism. We see terrorists, people who don't believe in democracy, people who believe that with the destruction of buildings, with the murder of people, they can somehow achieve a political purpose. They can destroy buildings, they can kill people, and we will be saddened by this tragedy, but they will never be allowed to kill the spirit of democracy.
In the space of a few hours, the landscape of New York had been changed in an apparently coordinated attack that could barely have been imagined. The symbols of the devastation were as powerful as the devastation itself. Mike Wooldridge, BBC News.
Reaction to the attacks on the World Trade Center and the Pentagon have come from leaders around the world. Geeta Gurumurthy has this report.
Housing one of America's key enemies, the Taliban regime has denied Osama bin Laden was the man behind today's horrific events. The Taliban ambassador to Pakistan condemned what he called the terrorist attacks and said they don't allow bin Laden to use the asylum of Afghanistan against any country. If it's not bin Laden, the speculation it could be a new deadly mix of disaffected Islamic groups. Today, the UN Secretary General said the world is traumatized.
There can be no doubt that these attacks are deliberate acts of terrorism, carefully planned and coordinated. And as such, I condemn them utterly. Terrorism must be fought resolutely wherever it appears. In such moments, cool and reasoned judgment are more essential than ever.
From the Middle East to Asia and Europe, world leaders have joined in condemnation. The Russian President Vladimir Putin said his people felt the pain of the Americans.
Сегодня Соединенные Штаты Америки.
He said today had proved the need for Russian plans for an international fight against terrorism. Britain, too, joined in the call for mass condemnation against an attack of mass terrorism.
This is not a battle between the United States of America and terrorism, but between the free and democratic world and terrorism.
NATO called an emergency meeting. Armed forces are on alert, but it's still not known who carried out this atrocity.
The Americans don't know, we don't know, but the clear message to whoever it was is that they will have left a trail behind them, and they can be assured that they will be found. And the international community, the whole international community, will be united in condemning what they've done and making sure that they're not in a position to do it again.
Governments everywhere are dazed by the destruction. From Iran, Syria, China, Ghana, words of condemnation. And from Cuba and South Africa, offers of humanitarian aid. And whilst the Bush administration may have incurred increasing wrath, especially in the Muslim world, the question remains, if America is this vulnerable, is anyone safe? Geeta Gurumurthy, BBC News.
Now, more on the latest building collapse in New York. You might have heard a few moments ago I was talking about the Salomon Brothers building collapsing. And indeed it has. Apparently that's only a few hundred yards away from where the World Trade Center towers were. And it seems that this was not a result of a new attack. It was because the building had been weakened during this morning's attacks. We'll probably find out more now about that from our correspondent, Jane Stanley. Jane, what more can you tell us about the Salomon Brothers building and its collapse?
Well, only really what you already know. Details are very, very sketchy. There's almost a sense downtown in New York behind me, down by the World Trade Centers, of just an area completely closed off as the rescue workers try to do their job. But this isn't the first building that has suffered as a result. We know that part of the Marriott Hotel next to the World Trade Center also collapsed as a result of this huge amount of falling debris from 110 floors of the two Twin Towers of the World Trade Center. As you can see behind me, the Trade Center appears to be still burning. We see these huge clouds of smoke and ash, and we know that behind that there's an empty piece of what was a very familiar New York skyline, a symbol of the financial prosperity of this city, but completely disappeared now, and New York is still unable to take on board what has happened to them today.
Presumably there were very few people in the Salomon building when it collapsed. I mean, there were, I suppose, fears of possible further collapses around the area.
That's what you would hope, because this whole downtown area behind me has been completely sealed off and evacuated, apart from the emergency workers. That was done by the mayor, Rudy Giuliani, much earlier today, because of course, the dreadful collapse of the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center. But New York, very much a city still in chaos. The phones are not working properly. The subway lines are not working properly. And we know that down there near the World Trade Center, there are three schools that are being turned into triage centers for emergency treatment. And I know that over in New York Harbor, where the famous Statue of Liberty is, there's a field hospital where 1,500 people are being treated. And we have heard, though it's unconfirmed as yet, that 100 New York City police officers have been taken there as well for treatment. But we do need to confirm those figures for the officers.
It's now, what, some 8 hours since the attacks. Is there any estimate yet available of the number of casualties in the World Trade Center?
I think we can only go at this point with the words expressed by the mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani, that it's too frightening to think how many there could be. We know that it's about almost 300 people on the airliners that were used in these attacks. But you've got to remember, this was 9 o'clock. In the morning, on a Tuesday morning. It's busy in downtown Manhattan, in the financial district then. The World Trade Center itself has 50,000 workers. There are tens of thousands of tourists who go up there every day. The figures are almost too frightening to contemplate. You can understand why nobody yet wants to put a figure on them.
Listening to the mayor, Rudy Giuliani, a bit earlier, one of his messages was, you know, business as usual. You know, we won't let this get us down. But presumably, a lot of Manhattan people must have fled the city to Long Island to get away from possible further attacks.
Well, a lot of people were certainly trying to, but you remember that very early on, all the bridges and tunnels to the city, as well as the airports, were closed. New York was sealed, essentially. Now, we do know that the Long Island Railroad has begun running again to get people out of the city if they can, and people who can't manage to get out and perhaps lived in that area, they're being offered accommodation in empty school buildings. But certainly I saw earlier on today huge crowds of people desperately trying to walk up upper Manhattan to get as far away as possible. I think nobody really knows how to go or where to go, and you have to remember, even now, I don't think people can sink in to people what's happened.
We haven't for the past hour or so heard much from the people of Manhattan. You're with them there. I mean, what are they saying tonight after this catastrophic attack?
As I said, many just cannot believe this has happened, and I've seen, you know, big burly men and women with the, you know, tears in their eyes today, shaking their heads, wondering what on earth is going on. There was a sense of panic. Our reports from the scene were of people just absolutely horrified. And I've already seen some photographs of that a man took down in the downtown area. And it looks like the aftermath of a huge atom bomb or something, just full of debris and of like a white carpeting of snow from all the dust and rubbish that had fallen. I don't think people can comprehend. They certainly have lost any feeling of safety. There's still a great pride in the city. People are determined to fight back, but a great sense of shock and loss. People keep looking at the sky, for example, where you can see the plume of smoke and say, when that's gone, it won't be there anymore. Our Twin Towers won't be there. Such a symbol of New York.
Are they talking yet about revenge and what the government should do to counter this threat, or are they numb still?
I think people are still numb, and I don't think people are talking about revenge in that way at all yet. I think people are still too traumatized. We don't know how many people have been killed. We can't even put a figure, I think, when you talk to people on they don't even say how many people might have been killed and injured. And I think that feeling, until the idea of the devastation, people don't really know what to say or what to think. I think they feel the bubble of their security as being in America has definitely been popped. This city and this country will not be the same. But they don't really know where to turn. That's the very sad thing. I think there's going to be a lot of very, very traumatized people that has hit them very, very hard.
Jane, I think many of us, when we heard the news, perhaps on the radio earlier today, were completely flabbergasted by it and just couldn't comprehend it. I mean, it almost sounded too far-fetched. I was wondering what it's felt like for you being in Manhattan. Well, unfortunately, I think we've lost the line with Jane Stanley in Manhattan. Perhaps we can rejoin her and follow that up later.
Always shown by the media. Negative images is the main criteria. Infecting the young minds faster than bacteria. Kids wanna act like what they see in the cinema. Yeah. Whatever happened to the values of humanity? Whatever happened to the fairness and equality? Instead of spreading love, we're spreading animosity. Lack of understanding leading us away from unity. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling under. That's the reason why sometimes I'm feeling down. It's no wonder why sometimes I'm feeling under. Gotta keep my faith alive, love is found.